Good morning. In this episode, you could be the one who picks the name of a brand new paint for Army Painter, and you win a big paint bundle as well. We're going to be looking at a brand new movie that's all about wargaming. We're going to be taking a look at the latest kind of creepy elven releases for Age of Sigmar. Stunning stuff. Wait for that. And then we have a couple of interviews that you may well want to watch. But first, let's take a look at Miniature Wargaming the movie.
Doesn't matter who you are. Like I've known doctors, firemen, captains, construction workers, college kids. It doesn't matter what you are in the real world. In this world, you're a general on the battlefield.
It's shaped who I've become and how my life has progressed.
Me and Adam have been wargaming together for a long time now. He looks too cool for wargaming, but he's really not.
I'm Matt Rattenbury. I'm based in Okehampton in Devon, and I'm a dispensing optician by day and a gamer by night.
Well, what I did when I was a kid was be a soldier, and I was a soldier, and I really enjoyed it.
Military games have a huge history. H.G. Wells, the great science fiction writer who wrote War of the Worlds, of course, that's what he's most famous for. In 1911, he actually wrote a little book called Floor Games. The other really enormous phenomenon as it became from the 1970s is the emergence of Games Workshop.
I think my generation really took wargaming from being a minority hobby to being something that was quite popular.
Under the mighty Rick Priestley, who was my evil boss.
It's the bit in Gordon Ramsay's Kitchen Nightmares where it all goes wrong.
Money is so tight, the budget is so tight in this household, I have to think about my family.
That's the final straw for me. I snapped and I was on guard duty one day and I was sitting there and I just found myself with the barrel of me rifle in my mouth.
Hi guys, so you've seen the trailer, and I'm joined by Joe Piddington, director, producer,
a bit of everything, I guess. Yeah, director.
The
I
creative
guess.
Mind.
The creative mind. I don't really like the word
miniature
director.
Miniature Wargaming, the movie.
Yes.
Okay. It's coming to Kickstarter, but we'll get to that.
Yep.
I just want to talk about the movie itself. Okay. Now, I will hold my hands up to being whenever I first heard of Miniature Wargaming, the movie. I did wonder to myself, and it just probably shows a lack of creativity on my part. And where would you go with a movie like that? Having seen the trailer, I am utterly sold. I'm utterly sold.
The
trailer just left me going, "Oh bollocks! I want to see this now. I don't want to wait." It looks really interesting. I love the characters in it. I love the people that you've found there. I think it just has it has a lot to it that I wasn't expecting.
Yeah, and I think that's what a lot of people are really going to see and appreciate. And obviously, everyone's now watched the trailer. And the main thing doing the documentary is me coming into it. I didn't want it to be a dry what we've seen before and what you know. I'm trying to remove the stereotype and the stigma on the industry. And I think that was the most important thing for me, was to find characters that are relatable.
Yeah.
And to find, to show that it doesn't matter if you have never picked up a miniature before, that you can somehow find a character in this that's relatable and hopefully will bring people, not only gamers and people that have been in the industry, also people that have also looked in on the industry and maybe partners and wives that don't really understand what their, you know, boyfriends, husband, girlfriends are really into, but it's more a, I guess, a wider audience. That's the whole goal for me, is to, you know, reach as many people as possible with this film. And I think by having main characters and really shows that.
Yeah. One of the, it's the key stories that you're telling, you know, it's, you know, I from the little bit that I saw, you know, of Chris Nichols, the mind behind Macrocosm, and Chris's, you know, you could feel his devotion to his family. You can feel just how hard that fellow has to work within this industry just to get to the basics in life. Yeah. You know, we can relate to that, actually, and I'm sure a lot of people in the industry will relate to that. It'll be interesting to see just how much the actual gamers and consumers themselves can relate to that, and can maybe get an understanding of, oh, actually, I didn't realize that behind the scenes in a lot of this stuff, that it's a lot more difficult. There's a lot more hardship than what you might expect. The one character that did surprise me in a fantastic way was the ex-soldier.
Yes. Andy Bryant.
That moment when he described being on guard duty, and his exact words about the barrel of the gun in his mouth, and I was like, oh wow,
it's really impactful. I've actually got shivers when you say, because it really is, and like, these are true stories at the end of the day. You know, nothing's been staged or anything, and these are things that have happened, and working with these people has been absolutely incredible, because they have been so open and really let us into their lives and shown the hardships they've been through. Not only, you know, just as a miniatures and into the industry, but on a personal level. And that was my main goal with the documentary, is because I'm still telling stories, as much as, you know, the history is such a key thing, but having relatable characters, so showing the history, but showing it as it goes through and interlocks with all these characters along the way, was the main goal for me when I was, you know, putting the concept of the idea together.
Yeah, it was fabulous to see it. You know, we've been very fortunate here in Beasts of War to have, you know, a lot of our viewers are ex-service people, and we've received a lot of letters, emails. Yeah, I like calling them letters, but we've received a lot of letters from ex-service men and women who have found, not necessarily Beasts of War, but, you know, the hobby and the community and the stuff, and they have found that to be a place of solace periodically.
Yeah.
Because clearly, you know, for people that are suffering this horrendous condition, places of solace is a difficult place to be, and they have to work to get there. And to just see that,
it's
making an appearance in the movie, that was, for me personally, it was an instant credibility moment. I thought, right, this is the attention level that this deserves now has just skyrocketed for me anyway.
Yeah, and it's exactly what you're saying. That's at the end of the day, I'm a hobbyist at heart, and I've always wanted, you know, it's one of those things, I've always waited for somebody to do a documentary about the industry, because I've always been intrigued about it. And but the things that I've always seen for me personally have always kind of hardened a bit of the stigma, the old things of how, you know, it's portrayed and the industry's portrayed. And as you can tell from seeing the documentary and the trailer, and that's just a real small part of the whole film, but it was getting those characters that have been through it, and how this industry and miniatures have helped them. Mm-hmm. Not only has, you know, because it's not just a job, it's not just, it is, this industry becomes you, and if once you're a gamer, you're a gamer. And I think you see that in these stories, and you see how they, you know, they really do go through a road of triumphs and tribulations throughout, but the thing that is helping them along the way is the industry. Yeah. So that was really important for me to kind of get across, that it's not a stigma anymore. It's, you know, it's a really important subject matter and an industry that needs to have the spotlight shone on it.
And we need to wear our badge of pride. You know, this industry becomes part of our fabric. You know, and for lots of years, you know, we've went through the, you know, the reluctance to talk about it. I don't have any choice anymore. I have to talk about it. But I often tell the story of when I met my wife. It was like 3 months before I told her, and it was that moment of walking along and saying, "I have to share something with you." Now, she was expecting the worst. You know, so, but you know, when I explained it, she said, "Well, why have you taken this long to tell me? It's lovely and blah blah." And she gets involved and stuff. You know, but you know, you're absolutely right. It's time to shake off the stigma now. Yeah. Really, you know, it's this hobby means so much to so many people in so many different ways.
Yes.
And you know, and it helps us all in so many different ways. You know, wear it, just wear it and be it. Now you're going back to Kickstarter.
Yes.
I want to make sure that we're clear on this. So you ran a small Kickstarter.
Yes, we did.
To put together the movie. Okay. You're now coming to the end phase and beginning the whole post production phase and whatnot now. So funds the first funds that have been done have been now allocated and worked their way through.
Yes.
Okay. So you're now coming back. Okay. So there's a couple of different constituents we want to talk about.
Yes.
Before we get to new people who I hope will go and back this. Okay. Let's talk a little bit about the folks who have already backed it the first time around. Can you just explain what this means for them? And
so, the original Kickstarter backers, I think we had 262 backers, something like that. And if it wasn't for them, we would not be here. Yeah. I wouldn't be sitting here right now. And to be honest, the documentary wouldn't be getting made. Up to before we did the original Kickstarter, it was self-funded. I funded it myself, and we got a small little loan grant. But we scratched the surface. That's what it was. And I had this idea late last year, well, it's been over a year now, when we went to Kickstarter, and it was, okay, this is what I want to tell. I want to try to shine a light on this industry in documentary form. So we did all the legwork, got to that point, and when we did the original budget, a lot of the stuff that's in this film now wasn't even in the original film. Yeah. So Chris is a character, Andy is a character, neither of those were even in the film. Mm-hmm. What I quickly found is that, as amazing as this industry is, I felt that we needed personalities and characters that we could follow in the industry, because I didn't want to just have lots and lots of interviews with people that, you know, because there's interviews out there, you know, the Perrys and Rick Priestley and John, and you know, you've had them all on the show. But it was more to try to, let's put something into one place and let's tell the history story, but we need to find a relatable link. So people that maybe don't really care about who these interviewees are, that they would come and watch this film.
Yeah.
And that's what I was really kind of struggling for, and was looking, and that's the honest answer. We were always looking, even during that, for people to follow and to have characters and storylines that we could interlock throughout the history.
Yeah.
So that's what we were looking for. So those two main characters weren't even budgeted for. And the reality is, we met Andy and we met Chris in the journey of making the history side. And that's when I quickly realized that these guys are aren't just, you know, a quick interview. These have real personal stories, and it was exactly what we were looking for. So that was why the budget, and you know, we have, you know, the budget has been spent on things that we didn't originally budget for. So the post-production side we did put to one side has now been used to get those stories in.
Yeah.
So that's why we're now coming to Kickstarter to raise more money. But going back to the original question, because I think I've gone off a little bit, is that the original backers, this will not affect them whatsoever.
Yeah. Let me give some context to this, all right? Because, you know, when we talk about films, a lot of people, the same way as when we talk about, you know, wargaming companies, they start to get probably a lot more zeros on there than yes. what is actually the case. How much did you raise in the original Kickstarter?
After fees were taken away, yeah. we got about £5,000.
Okay, so we're talking about £5,000 yeah. in the original Kickstarter.
Yeah.
To make anything
yes.
movie-wise on £5,000, yeah. I've got to say, is a miracle. I am not in the slightest surprised that in a documentary format, as a filmmaker, that it only started to present itself to you as you began the production yeah. process. That, for any filmmaker involved in documentaries, more often than not, that is how it yeah. goes. It's not like a movie that you can completely storyboard and then just capture. When you're capturing real life, believe it or not, real life presents yes. itself, yeah. along with all the twists and turns yeah. and things that you would expect. Also, as a filmmaker, I'm so enamored with the approach, just from the trailer that I've seen, yeah. that I would have expected nothing less than you to tell the stories of real people and give me people that I can engage with. And, you know, I'm just hoping for a happy ending. I'm a happy ending sort yeah. of a guy, you know. But yeah. I know only too well in this industry that happy endings, you know, it's not only hard work. You need a big dollop of luck and yeah. stuff as well. So, you know, I'm on tenterhooks myself to see you know, where this story ends in this iteration. Yeah. So existing backers are going to get all their
yes,
pledges
yeah, they're
going
to get it. They're going to date. We're still on time schedules and everything. Mm-hmm. They're going to get. And one thing that the special edition backers, that we are basically upgrading them to the new special edition completely mm-hmm. for free.
Yeah.
As just a thank you to, and I think that was really, really key, because they were the original backers, and I genuinely, you know, we would not be making the film if it wasn't for them.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that. So I wanted to not give back, but, you know, I wanted to make sure that they were taken care of.
Yeah.
By, you know, because I knew it would throw up issues, mm-hmm. and I completely understand that. I've backed Kickstarters before, and, you know, well, you didn't budget for it properly, vice versa. All those sort of questions always come up. But at the end of the day, I feel that we've been as open, as honest as possible.
Yeah.
And we've told people along the way, you know, even before we decided to go back to Kickstarter, we did send things out to our backers and we're asking them, you know, we need a bit more money. If you've got any ideas, let us know. Mm-hmm. Those sort of things. So, and so far, we've had a very positive response that's been very good. Obviously, we've had a few people that have got doubts, and I completely understand that, because, you know, we promised a product and now we're asking for more money. But the one thing that I want to make abundantly clear is the fact that even if this Kickstarter isn't successful, we can still produce a film.
Yeah.
The problem is, we can make a good film, but I want to make a great film.
Yeah.
And I haven't spent over a year of my life, and I haven't had, you know, teams of people from not just the UK but around the world give up their time to help, because everyone on the film has worked completely for free so far. And we haven't spent over a year doing this to kind of just not try at the final hurdle. And that's what it comes down to. I would feel like I was cheaping not only myself but the backers and everyone else that's going to watch the film by, at least now I can say, well, I tried. You know, and if we fail, we fail, but at least I've tried, and at least I can hold my head up and say, we gave it a go, here is a good film, and it is a, you know, it's a very, very good film, it's very, very strong, but I know it can be a great film, and it's as simple as that. And
yeah.
if I'm going to work on something, and I'm going to put something out, I want to be able to put my name on it and be proud of that thing.
Yeah.
And as proud as I possibly can be. So that's the goal, and that's what I'm trying to do.
New backers, then.
Yes.
Okay, so for people that want to jump in in this Kickstarter, the Finish the Job Kickstarter.
Come on! Okay?
If they want to jump in, what are the rewards? What can they expect?
So we've got a few different rewards coming up. We've got a very similar tier system that we did last time. Unfortunately, costs have gone up, so it's slightly a bit more expensive than it was on the original Kickstarter. That all comes down to pretty much we want to produce a better thing. So yeah. We're now, you know, paying for new artwork to be done on the box art. We're paying for new models to be added, and we've got a few down here that we can show later on. Mm-hmm. And all those sort of things. And at the end of the day, we're going to Kickstarter to raise money to finish making the film.
Yeah.
We're not going there to sell a product. We need the money to actually, you know, go to finish the film.
Well, let's talk about finishing the film,
yes.
Okay? Because up until now, the original Kickstarter and your own self-funding has
yep.
been funding your time, it's been funding yep. all the administration, it's funded equipment, it's yep. funded travel. You've squeezed a lot of out of yeah. $5,000, I've got to say, because you know I've seen the cameras. I know the price of cameras. We collectively, as a community, yeah. know the price of cameras. What is this next round going towards? Because one of the other things that I'm very aware of, as expensive as this front end bit can be,
yeah.
when you get into post production, you're talking some real professionals'
yes.
time in terms of you know their. They're working After Effects and
yes.
color corrections
yep.
and everything else.
Yep.
So what is this stage of the project entail?
Well, yeah, you've hit the nail on the head. So we originally budgeted in the original Kickstarter for color grading.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, the company we were going to use, because we were paying for that, they have increased in price because they actually have become very, very successful. And the summer last year, they ended up getting a big Hollywood film. That meant that they got a big blockbuster, so they had to hire more staff, so their costs have gone up. And unfortunately, they're just too much for us at the moment, when we'd love to use them, but, you know, that's blown that idea. So color corrections are huge importance. You know, we're, at the end of the day, we're making a feature film, and it's got to be color graded. We're not just going to put something out that isn't done to the highest standard. So that's one thing. The other thing is, it's kind of a big chunk, is licensing. One of the crucial parts in the film is the history, and I want to be able to show footage, archive footage, and get those licensed things that unfortunately you do have to pay for. You know, we can't just use them for free at the end of the day. So there's footage of the war in Kosovo, so we have to actually, you know, lease and get the rights for segments to go in when these things a place, but obviously it's owned by the news companies that have got them originally. So that's one expense, and then archive footage, like historical footage or photos that aren't out in the general public, that mm-hmm. you know you can't just be used. So
yeah.
they're the sort of things that we're looking at the moment that I think will add such a more of a depth to a documentary, because mm-hmm. it's all well and good having talking heads and somebody, you know, talking about the history. But if you've got no visuals to go with that, and at the end of the day, you know, we're making a film, the visuals are, you know, half the battle at the end
yeah.
of the day. So that's really, really key. So getting the money to pay for those licenses is another big expense. And then the other thing is film festivals. You know, the whole goal at the end of the day is to get this to as many film festivals, to get it out into the general public so the world knows about this amazing industry.
Yeah.
So, but that costs money.
Yeah.
And at the moment, you know, we don't have that money to do that.
Yeah.
And that is the goal. So that's the more expensive things that we're looking to. And then you've obviously got wages for other things, and we've still got travel costs to pay for and a few more expenses, because we filmed about 90%, 95% of the film now, but we've still got a few more interviews to get. We need to wrap up the stories, because there's a few stories that we haven't quite wrapped up. So yeah, it's all that sort of to get the last bit out of it.
Yeah. You have something along to show.
Yes.
Will we crack it open and,
yep.
and have a look at it?
So
what is this?
This then? Is the special edition, a very early prototype.
Yes.
So this is the first time it will be seen. So this will be the special edition.
Uh-huh.
And it's going to come with a sleeve. It's going to be a printed sleeve with all your lovely information. We're going to have the poster art and all the things there. and then we've got the tin. Because for us, we're trying to, you know, it's going to be a high-end product.
Mm-hmm.
So we've gone with a nice metal tin. We're going to have the screen print. This is the test printing. This isn't the final concept. This is early concept art.
Mm-hmm.
And then inside, we're going to be having the... We've got a few little goodies. So what will actually happen is these will be foam inserts, and then these are the some of the exclusive minis that will be in the special edition. So we've got five exclusive miniatures. We've got one from Warlord that is a Celt chieftain.
Mm-hmm.
That is this guy here. He's got a little shield. And then we've got a... One of the miniatures from Wild West Exodus.
Yep. And
then we've got from Macrocosm Miniatures, we've got a Grandmaster Dwarf is the name for that one. And then we're still waiting on one to come through that's from Futsal Miniatures. It's a Roman General.
Yeah.
And then this is the one. This is the H.G. Wells one that we has been sculpted by the Alan Perry. And this is, we've actually... Because H.G. Wells is such an important part in the film, we have had to go to his family and get the rights to show pictures and talk about Little Wars and things like that. And one of the things that I approached them and I said, what would be amazing is to get H.G. Wells miniature. Mm-hmm. And if we could get permission to have that done, you know, we had to go to one of the best sculptors in the industry to do it. So, yeah, this is the H.G. Wells miniature that it will only be, and all of these miniatures you can only get in the special edition.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to come on these little plimps, and they're just little gems. They really are. We do have the actual, for the H.G. Wells one, we have the green that Alan Perry sculpted.
There it is.
And then we've got a really lovely antiqued one.
Oh, yes. Very nice.
Yeah. So all lovely little goodies that you can only get by getting the special edition. The special edition comes with these, and they are limited. It's a limited run. We're going to be producing 250 on this campaign.
Mm-hmm.
It will come with all five. Unfortunately, we don't have the final one that's been sculpted. All five miniatures, the Blu-ray, a DVD of the film as well, because we didn't want, if you didn't have a Blu-ray player, you wouldn't want to back it. So we've got a DVD and Blu-ray, and also we'll be including the special edition behind the scenes. It's a 20-minute documentary that's about the making of the film.
Yeah.
And then the final thing is, it's going to come with each figure. It's going to have a little card that we're working on at the moment, and each studio is going to, and it's going to have a description about them, and it's going to have which number issue it is from the special edition. So we're trying to get it as rare as possible, because at the end of the day, that's what it is, you know.
Yeah.
You're not going to get this anywhere else, and these miniatures, you're definitely not going to get anywhere else, so.
Well, guys, look, there you have it, Miniature Wargaming, the movie. We're going to be continuing to run some little trailers and interviews and things like that over the coming weeks. Be sure to go and check it out. If you haven't, go to the start of the show and have another view of that trailer. It looks like powerful stuff. Joe, look, thank you so much for coming on board.
Thanks very much for having me.
Head on over with the link to the Kickstarter is in the show notes. Right, we're going to tell you about some hubs.
Flames of War brings you the battles of World War II in epic 15mm scale. Go to the hub on beastofwar.com to find news, tactics, and tutorials about the game. In a world controlled by massive corporations, a steady aim and split-second decisions are needed for your Megacon to complete its goals. Begin your missions at the Mercs Hub on beastofwar.com.
Well, so there we have it from Joe Piddington himself. I'm excited about it. For a movie that I initially was wondering, where do you go with that? He clearly had a plan. Well, I say he clearly had a plan. He clearly had the expertise to create a plan of where it's going. So it's we'll stay tuned for that. Head on over to the Kickstarter and check it out. Okay, Justin, we have an Army Painter competition. Now,
yes,
we've got an interview with Bo from Army Painter a little bit later in the show, but do you want to just give us a rundown on the competition and how it works?
Yeah, basically, the guys from Army Painter have a new line of paints coming out. So they're going to be expanding their current range, but they're also adding a ton of new things to it. So if I quickly read off some stuff, they're going to be doing a rough iron, war paints mix and medium, military shader, some dry rust, and stuff like that. But you could be in with the chance of getting to actually name one of the new paints. Now, the paint in question, we will have some images for it. It's going to be a light acrylic blue paint. Now, some of the general things the guys from Army Painter say for actually naming their paints is...
Oh, so we get some constraints here.
Yeah, well, it's generally a double-barreled name, so it'll be like leather brown, you know, uniform gray, so things like that. So it doesn't actually have to have the color in the name, but it can help to describe it. So it's a descriptive name of what this color is going to be used for. So I will say this, only comments on Beast of War are going to be included for this competition.
Right, so come on over to beastofwar.com. If you haven't created a free account, create a free account and get in there and comment.
Yeah, no.
Can I call it Blue Lagoon?
Blue Lagoon? Possibly. I don't know if the shade's quite right.
If I called it Blue Magoon, me and Ben would have to get a bottle of it and smear it all over each other.
You do realize that's a mixer they do up at the local pub. I actually quite enjoy that one.
Okay.
But no, other than that, I will be sitting down to talk with Bo about, you know, what they're doing and what they're planning. And they do have some interesting stuff coming for companies that they're beginning to partner up with. So we get a first look at some of that as well. So
well, stay tuned one of the things I'm really interested in is this Warpaint's mixing medium. Because I'm wondering if that is going to act as a nice thinner for running it through airbrushes potentially as well.
You see, I think the mixing medium is more for combining colors to actually make your own custom colors across your palette. But the actual prize is fantastic for this because the winner is going to get the entire new range, every last color.
Do you know how many colors there are?
It's over 120. I don't have the exact number, but it's over 120. But
that's a big range.
It is. But the great thing is, the person that wins is actually going to get it when it's produced, not when it's going to retail release, which is going to be in February.
They get it first then?
They get it before anybody else, whenever the actual product run is finished, which is going to be very, very cool. I think the product run, they're looking at around October time for it.
And the paint will be named, the name that they have chosen.
Yes.
So you'll be able to go to your mates, I think you should paint that blue. Try this color.
My amazing, fabulous blue. Super
awesome. Right, well, wait for the interview, and good luck. Get your names, your name ideas below. Right, I think it's time for some news. Ben, I want to kick off with the Age of Signar, okay? The Sylvaneth, is that how we pronounce this one?
Yes, that's the one, yeah. So these guys are going to be one of the new factions that comes to Age of Sigmar, based a little bit off the Wood Elves from the old Warhammer universe. And these guys are going to be the fellows that you'll be fighting over and with in the Realm of Life when the summer campaign comes out.
Yeah.
And we got to look at a few of really sort of awesome-looking leaks for these guys to show off some of the models they've got in their range.
Oh. Yeah. I tell you what,
really
the first thing that came to my mind, Ben, when I look at these was Hellboy.
Yes, it's really got a lot of like a Hellboy influence, maybe a little bit of Pan's Labyrinth in there as well.
Yeah.
Some people are also harking back to the old Rackham designs, first this kind of like Wood Elves and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's some really interesting models here, some fantastic looking characters and great use of sort of the wood and the organic together. It's really cool, fantastic looking stuff.
You know, as kind of Wood Elves go, these are badass. I'm looking at this one on the Scarab. Justin, what is that? Help me identify. What is that beast?
I have no idea. Are you sure it's a scarab?
That is Alariel, the Everqueen. So she's going to be the one that leads them into battle. Mm. And the thing that she's riding on is like a stag beetle almost. Right. So I think it's like a huge over the top beetle that they're using for her.
Hang on. Stag beetle, is that? I'm thinking dung beetle for some reason. I could be completely wrong here. Am I wrong?
Dung beetles are the ones from Egypt that you would have seen pushing around the big balls of poo. Yeah.
Sorry.
I tell you what, Justin.
I could be wrong.
We can get you to model that as a dung beetle. All right. And we'll get you a decorative base.
Right.
And you can give it pure authenticity. You can even roll up your own. Never worry.
I have never played with poo. I never will play with poo.
You know, I can totally see Justin creating an entire dung beetle army. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, coming soon from some of the
geeks. When is it due, Ben?
It should be out this week or the week after, so you've not got long to wait for this one. I just want to point out as well that one of the really cool units within this are the Kurnoth Hunters, and they're the guys that we've talked about how much I love Treekin before and stuff like that. They're the guys that are basically the tree men. They come with the really awesome bows and swords and stuff like that. Can't wait for those guys.
These guys.
So yeah, some really nice stuff.
Yeah, they are absolutely mean looking. Now the other thing is we have the Gore Chosen game coming up now as well, Ben.
Yeah, so another one of the big things that Games Workshop announced, and a little bit the same style as they did with Lost Patrol, is that months in advance they talked about a game called Gorechosen, as you say, and this is a sort of small boxed game where you take control of one of four Khorne champions mm-hmm. who are fighting for the favor of Khorne himself in a bloodthirsty arena. So it's a little tiny game that you can play with the heroes, and then you could translate them to Silver Tower and stuff like that. But yeah, nice little way to get your hands on four new heroes for this.
Now, does it cross over to Silver Tower? Like, what do you need to take the... I take it there's four heroes in the box of that game, Ben, yeah?
Yes, yeah. So you get the four heroes in the box for Gorechosen, and each of those heroes actually has a profile for Silver Tower. So if you wanted to, all you need to do is go over to the app, buy it for 79p, and then you'd be able to play with your characters from Gorechosen in Silver Tower as well.
I'm really liking all this crossover stuff that's going on.
So hang on, you could play through Silver Tower with a Chaos-inspired warband, yeah?
Yes, you could, yeah. You could play with all four of the core champions if you really wanted to.
Yeah. I really like where they're going with this. You know, it's there's attention to detail in it. Yeah, some of these games are what would we say? They're almost disposable in some sense. But I think I know what's behind this. Right. Mm-hmm. I visited James M. Hewitt's house one time, and he had a cupboard full of board games.
Right.
Okay. And him and his better half, and myself and Lloyd, just spent an evening playing board games. We just pull out quick board games and we'd play them. Mm. So I can feel a lot of James's influence here in understanding that sometimes some of these quicker, smaller, faster games. Yeah, they'll sit there. They might sit there for 9 months between plays. But whenever it comes to if you want to play something quicker, if you want a night where you play lots of different things, these are the games that you reach for. And you pull them out, and you get two or three quick rounds in, and then you go, right, well, what shall we try next? Yeah. And I like where it's going. I like it works if they as long as you stay committed to it. And they certainly are staying committed to it because there's lots and lots of these building up now. So it just gives a lot of different flavor and different ways of experiencing all of the different kind of characters from the universes that they rock.
Yeah, but it's nice to see them being able to port from one game to the other. You know, it's giving you a nice diversity with it and a nice flexibility to it as well.
Yeah. Well, talking about diversity, we're now seeing the General's Compendium.
Yeah, so the big handbook, the big rule book for Age of Sigmar is going to be coming out very soon. There's a couple of people out there who have got some reviews and stuff already, which is pretty awesome. So we'll put some links below and stuff like that if you want to go and check those out. But this looks really cool in the preview they showed off, which basically went into the detail of the contents page.
Yeah.
So you get to know effectively what's going to be in there. And as well as all the army lists, they've included a whole bunch of different ways to play because they're going down this triple threat path and stuff like that. And one of the really big things that stuck out for me is the way they're doing the Path to Glory. And this is almost like your progressive, continuing narrative scenario-based campaign, where you start with a leader and a couple of units, and then you grow your army slowly over time, which is exactly how most people want to play these kind of games.
Yeah.
And I think this could be the really big hit. I'm definitely looking forward to getting stuck into that.
So what is a triple threat path?
Cool. So, well, they've gone down the way of either playing the completely free and open way of playing Age of Sigmar, which is the way that you play it now. So this is the sort of like, yeah, we'll just chuck whatever we want onto the table and play it like that. Then there's the narrative way, which is all based around campaigns, and that's to do with Path to Glory and things. And then the last one is matched play. And matched play is the one which involves all the points costs and stuff. Now, there's no reason you can't cross over a few things here and there and stuff like that. It's effectively your handbook to do what you want with. But those are the sort of three defined areas that they're trying to sort of aim at. So you've got the people who love the story, the people that just love to play around with models, and then the people who really want to get down to the tournament side of things and play with the points costs.
Awesome. Looking forward to seeing that.
One thing I'm seeing here that has me more than a little excited for this.
Yeah.
So if we have a look at the very last bit here.
Yes, the allegiances.
Grand Alliances of the Realms.
Yeah.
I like the idea of this because it's going to let you start to do some mixed warbands.
Yeah.
And it's going to let you actually take stuff that you like from one collection to the other collection. Because this is something you have talked about before, Warren, where you actually say, you know, whenever it was things like Warhammer Quest, you want everything because you could play everything together.
Yeah.
Having stuff like that, I think, is really great for allowing people to really expand the collections and not limit themselves to a faction.
Oh, absolutely. This is where the potential, I suppose, the potential double hit of Age of Sigmar and Silver Tower start to come in. You know, they are opening it up to allow you to do larger collections. And the thing is, it's I don't know, Ben, but it kind of feels to me that the Age of Sigmar background suits mixed war bands potentially better than even 40K, for that matter. You know, I think it suits that kind of collector type feel.
The nature of the way that the world has been set up with these different realms and things like that, where people can pass between them and stuff like that. And a lot of the allegiances themselves are very much fragile alliances that you might make between enemies and stuff. I mean, you just have to look at the Silver Tower for that, where you've got a Chaos guy hanging out with a Stormcast Eternal and things.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's really interesting to see how you can come up with some fantastic combinations for this. Mm-hmm. And I think the background is starting to grow and sort of find its feet. And there's a lot of stuff out there now for people who want to get stuck into it, I think. So.
Well, yeah. Find me that Sylvaneth on the dung beetle there, Justin, because you know, it kind of highlights my point, right?
There you go.
Look at that, right? That miniature is just incredible. You know, it's like a work of art. In many respects, you know, I've spent most of the day on and off looking at it yesterday, and I just can't get over just the beautiful fine details in it. You know, like, who wouldn't want to have something like that, you know, added to their collection? You know, so it's and this is the thing: if you make collectible models, if you can give people excuse to collect them, they'll take it. You know,
if
I really like
play
it.
Play with
yeah.
them as well as collect them. You know, you're not just grabbing it, building it, painting it, putting it on a shelf, and going, "Oh, look, it's pretty." You're bringing it down and actually playing and making stories with it.
Yeah.
Which is one of the real keys to actually engaging with your collection and actually building love for your collection.
Yeah. Right. Next up, this week saw the launch of two new starter sets for Dead Zone, Ben.
Yeah, so these are up on the Mantic web store now, so you can go and have a look at them. They've now added the Rebs and Marauders to the list of sort of factions you can play for Dead Zone. Mm-hmm. They have both their starter sets, which you can go and pick up, and they also included some booster packs as well. So if you wanted to sort of expand your faction in a different way, you could add a few aliens here and there with their booster packs that they do, which effectively are like having another starter set on top of what you've already got, which is pretty cool. So
yeah. I've got to say... as time has went on, I have really grown to love the Rebs side of things.
Yeah,
you know, it's,
the Rebs are my favourite. I sort of see them a little bit as sort of, imagine if you mixed Star Wars and the Rebels and like the guys from the crew from Firefly. It's that sort of Wild West of the Mantic world that I really like about these guys. Yeah,
it's that vibe that's getting me as well. It has a Star Wars kind of a feel to it, where you just get this ragtag bunch of various creatures and aliens, and they're just out to try and get whatever they can.
Well, I'll tell you what, I think I may actually have some of these sitting about in my collection of random stuff somewhere. So I'll see if I can hunt them out for you, Warren. And
because I'd love to have a look at them.
Yeah.
Now, another thing that you guys are going to be excited about is we are now seeing the War Machine and Hordes two-player starter sets. Mm.
Yes, yeah, so these popped up as well towards the end of last week, actually, for these. But they've actually shown off the full contents for what you're going to be getting for both the War Machine and the Hordes two-player starter sets. For the World of War Machine, you're going to have Signar facing off against Krix. Signar are led by Major Beth Maddox, and Krix have Bane Witch Agathea.
Yeah.
And these are the new characters from the smaller battle sort of battle boxes as well. So you can pick them up in different places. And for Hordes, we have Trollbloods.
Now, this is the one I'm looking forward to.
Yeah, led by Ragnar Skysplitter, who is
look
insane.
At that. That looks brilliant.
Yeah, and they're fighting off against Scorn with Beastmaster Zekar, which is pretty awesome. Yeah.
Now, I will say this is actually very clever of Privateer Press for the way they've actually done this, because the last starter sets they did, for War Machine, it was Kador versus Menoth. And I think it was Legion versus Circle of Orberus.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Now
yeah.
for the new starter sets, they're using the other factions. So everybody's getting their turn at bat to actually be the starter force, you know, that face of War Machine or Hordes to get people into it.
Yeah.
So it'll be really interesting to see how people react to this, because I know for me, whenever I saw that two-player starter set, I've played Kator before, I've never really been interested in Menoth. I see Signar, I want Signar.
Yes.
You know.
As forces go, what do you think of the two armies that are in each box? Like, if you bring them up there and we get a couple of opinions on them.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so for the Signar, what we're seeing here is that they've got the basic starter box. So you've got Beth Maddox, you've got an Ironclad, you've got the Firefly, which is a fantastic little light jack. It is an incredible little piece to work with.
Yeah.
You've then got the ever-reliable Lancer, because it is that arc node on it.
Which one's the Lancer?
So you see the guy with the big spear and the shield with the Cygnus symbol on the left arm?
Point to him.
So this guy right here.
Yeah, that's it. That's easy, yeah.
Okay, so that's him. Okay. The Ironclad's the guy with the big hammer. And then you've got the Stormguard who are up behind.
Yeah.
Now, Signar, as we know, is a very electrical element-based faction. So that Firefly is given lots of bonus to electrical-style attacks. Mm-hmm. Those Stormguards, they've got some electric goodies on them as well, which is going to make them absolutely fantastic on the tabletop. The key to this entire starter set is that Lancer, because he has an ability which is called Arc Node. So your main caster, your Warcaster Beth, can actually cast spells, right? Mm-hmm. Through that arc node, she can actually use that light jack as if it was herself casting the spell. So you measure from her for casting that spell. You actually have a point on the table where you're going, it's like having me again, and I can cast from here. So you really increase the ranges that you can be casting out your spells at and really control the table a lot better.
Yeah.
Now, for the Crix side of things, I'm not quite such a fan of Crix, so I don't know them as well. But I'm seeing Slayer, I'm seeing some Banes. The Banes are actually really, really nasty in melee, from what I remember.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to be guessing, Crix in general, they deal with lots and lots of debuffs as a faction. So it's all entropy, you know, they're drawing the life out of you, capturing your souls, and actually turning you into one of these undead, steampunk, magic-powered creations.
Yeah.
Other than that, it looks like a really fun starter set, and I'm sure some people out there are going to have a lot of fun with the Crix side of things.
Mm-hmm.
Moving along to Hordes.
Ben, what do you think of the Trollbloods?
Well, I'm going to come at this from a slightly sort of more aesthetic point of view, because I'm not overly sure with the mechanics all the time with War Machine and Hordes, but I just love the style of what they've got in this box, which is fantastic. You get so much really cool stuff in there, some really nice models all in different types of poses and things like that. I actually managed to see Ragnar smashing things apart when we were at the Lock and Load event, which was pretty cool, and everyone was really loving him. So I think if you are a fan of Trollbloods, you're going to really like what they're doing with these guys. The thing that really makes, well, that I really love about Hordes as well is the reactionary side of it and how that plays. So instead of just sort of planning out your turn ahead of time, you've got a lot more sort of planning after the fact with these guys, and that's what I think the Trollbloods excel at very much so. They've got lots of nice little tricks in there as well, which is really cool.
And what about you? Yeah.
Well, for me, the Trollbloods have always been a really heavy, hard-hitting faction.
Bring these them up guys, again there, do we see?
These guys are absolutely rock-solid within the War Machine universe, because they get a rule called tough. Now, in War Machine, you generally don't get a save. When you're wounded, you're dead. Mm. These guys, they get a 4-up save, which no one else in the game gets. So these guys are, like, hard as nails. They cannot be killed. On top of that, you have this guy here, who's a bouncer. Now, he has a very, very cool ability called Beatback. So he can basically charge in front of somebody, ram them with the shield, and actually send them flying away from them to actually control the table zones a lot more.
Yeah.
You then have your Axer. He's a big, massive beat stick. You've then got your Impaler. He's basically going to be chucking spears left, right, and center. And then you've got this Fenblade unit. Now, this is going to be a great addition to it, because the Fenblades, they're a nice, big, hefty melee unit that can just rock in and just tear people a new one. It's absolutely great.
Are they very much close combat, these guys?
These guys, yeah. Trollbloods, you know, they're not exactly high-tech. On the Horde side of things, things suddenly go from, okay, big steam-powered war machines to, okay, natural elemental magics powering everything. It's the two dynamics that you still see between the two games. Because in War Machine, in Mark II, it always was, any focus you held on your caster at the end of your turn became a boost to armor, right?
Yeah.
They've changed that now, so that each point of focus that you're holding onto yourself, you can actually use to negate 5 points of damage. So it's bringing it a little bit closer to that Horde side of things, but Hordes, you still have that balancing act of, I will now spend Fury, and I will, instead of taking damage, transfer that exact damage to my War Beast for a point of Fury. Now, I think that may have changed slightly in the new edition as well. I'm not really up on Hordes just yet. I'm focusing on War Machine.
And what about the other faction?
The other faction, Scorn. Now, these guys have a very, very cool playstyle. They are all about whipping their beasts into a frenzy, so causing pain to actually get them to work and fight harder. They also use their whips to somehow heal their beasts. I assume this is some form of magic. You then have the legionary guys in the back. Let me actually get their name here. Praetorian Swordsmen. So these guys in the back, it's another decent little melee unit. Not quite so strong as what I think the Fenblades would be, but that's just a personal opinion for me. You're also getting this big-ass Titan Gladiator. He is just a big, nasty war beast ready to rock forward and basically crush you between his hands.
Yeah.
You've then got the two Cyclopses. You've got one for melee, one for ranged. It's going to be a really nice balanced force at the end of the day.
Well, I've got to say, I'm impressed. I'm impressed. I'm looking forward to getting you that faction to see you whipping your beasts to get them harder.
No. I'm a Signar player. I'm wanting to stick to the War Machine side of things to get back into Mark III.
I will just point out as well that with these sets, you also, as well as the models, you get loads of extra stuff as well, so that you can actually just get started playing. So it'll have all the tokens you need, dice, rulers, the maps, getting started guides. Basically, these are the place to go if you and a mate want to get stuck into this and start playing. But yeah.
And the great thing about it, and what I've always loved about the Privateer Press game, is that you could take your Horde's army down to your club or across to your mate and play against his War Machine army.
Yeah.
That crossover is... And they play very differently, but the fact that it's compatible...
Yeah.
I think that's just ingenious. I think it's probably the jewel in the crown of War Machine and Hordes is the fact that you can play, and it's not stuck together or anything. It is a totally effective way to play.
Yeah, well, you see, it's one of the dynamics. I was chatting to the guys at Lock and Load while we were there, and one of the key dynamics they wanted to change with this new rules update was, it used to be that early game, Hordes would have a major advantage over War Machine, simply because they could do so much with their stuff. Late game, they became incredibly weak whenever their War Beasts started to die, because the Fury mechanic was that they were drawing the Fury off the Beasts after they were being riled up.
Yeah.
So they've actually changed that now to balance things out. Now, you understand what happened with War Machine now, that any Warjack starting in your control area automatically generates one focus.
Yeah.
They had to have something similar to that for Hordes. So as your Beasts die, you have sort of a spirit bond ability with the beasts in your warband. So when they die, whenever it's dead, you automatically generate one back from that war beast. So that sort of eases things off and leaves you that you're not having to cut into your warlock's health to actually get that fury up and keep them running at a high efficiency.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but it is the one thing I have noticed for this. Whenever this came out, people started screaming, yes, we can run massive warjack armies. You can, but you don't need to, because my opinion is you can run spell heavy on this now and just have a nice level of warjacks. And then you've got more to actually do with your Warcaster. You can keep those buff and upkeep spells running a lot more efficiently.
Yeah.
You can be casting out damage more efficiently. Mm-hmm. But that's my initial thoughts on it.
Well, we'll put it to the test. Mm. Okay, last piece of news for this week is the Empire of Dust from Kings of War, Ben.
This was an army that effectively came out of basically nowhere. Like, we hadn't really heard a lot about this, and then sort of towards the end of last week we saw a really cool preview image that we managed to share on the website exclusively, which is very cool. But they actually went in and took a lot more photos of the army and sort of showed off some more of the units in there as well. So we got to look at the infantry, some of their monstrous units and things like that. There's also a shot of some of the characters too, and they also have siege weaponry, so they've got these really cool catapults that fire sort of screaming mad magical skulls and stuff like that. So some really interesting stuff coming out of Mantic that I don't think anybody anticipated happening at the moment, but really cool things.
I can kind of see where they've came from design-wise on this, because Mantic already have their undead, right?
Yeah.
I'm looking at some of the images here, and so you see the center of this image right here.
The mummies.
Which have been out for quite a while. So this feels like it's a nice big expansion on that sort of theme. And whenever you're looking at some of the other infantry and stuff, you can actually see that these guys have been upgraded from undead sprues that already exist within Mantic.
Yeah, so is it a set of metal upgrades then?
There are some upgrades to it. I don't know if they're metal or not, but you do have your nice character stuff and some of the newer units coming in.
I think
there
it
as
looks
well.
Amazing.
It really does. I love the big guys in it though.
I am disappointed on your behalf though, Justin. Because
really?
Yes, because I know that you have been looking at this desperate for dung beetles.
Ah, come on. We have a new mammoth. We have a new mammoth.
But Ben...
Is there a mummy mammoth?
I don't see any dung beetles, but surely... Don't go back to that picture. Surely dung beetles would have been ideal for those catapults.
Exactly. You could mount them on the back of some large dung beetles. You know, there's no rules with Kings of War. You can make whatever you want out of your regiment, so go for it. Yeah,
you're really worried about the footprint more than anything whenever it comes to Kings of War. But
there you go.
I don't know. Mantic always stick in the pets on the sprue, so we're maybe just not seeing them because they're maybe scuttling in around someone's feet on there.
Yeah. Well, there you have it. Right, we're going to take a very quick break. We're going to tell you about some hubs. After the break, we're coming back. And Justin's going to sit down with Bo from Army Painter to give you the lowdown on this new paint set that's coming. So we'll be right back after we tell you about some hubs.
Venture into the dangerous dungeons of Myth as a mighty hero and stand against the darkness. Visit the Myth Hub on beastofwar.com and begin your story. Fight for the Iron Kingdoms as a Warcaster. Take control of the mighty Jacks, arcane devices, and dark sorceries to bring the fight to the War Machine Hub on beastofwar.com.
Hi everybody, as you can see, I have been joined by Bo from the Army Painter. And Bo, you have a bit of an announcement to make with everybody. So what's going on?
Well, basically, the big thing we're working on right now is that we are expanding the current Warpaint range mm-hmm. into a complete wargaming range. Mm. With everything in it, like, you know, inks, metallics, effect paints, which is a bit of a new one for us, mm-hmm. and the expansion of our 42 range up to 124 mm-hmm. Different paints now. So it's supposed to be a complete wargaming range or selection of paints mm-hmm. that we've been working on for quite a while now. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, that's big for us.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, the Army Painter range has, up to date, it has been very primary. It has been very bright and very flashy, the colors that you've used. So am I right in assuming that we're going to see a lot more real-world colors, so a lot more along the lines of, say, you know, German camouflage stuff that you could knock onto World War II tanks, you know, things like that, yeah?
Yeah, well, we're going to get field gray. So on that one, you're spot on. We're still going to be very generic. We're still going to be sci-fi fantasy primarily, mm-hmm. With colors obviously picking in now. You can use for historical uses. In our range now, we have stuff like leather brown, and so which is sort of generic leather is leather mm-hmm. in many respects. But as a specific World War II line, this will not be as much. This will more be for any fantasy sci-fi game out there, basically, and modern ops.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, it's one of those things I've always loved about Army Painter is the way you've actually designed your system is to make it as easy as possible for people to get a good looking force down on the table. The simple fact that you color match all of your primers to your paints to be 100% match is an incredible, incredible feat. Is that something that's going to continue with this expanded range?
Yeah, absolutely. The only problem is that if I came out with 124 color primers, every single retail store in the world would try to kill me. we have 26 now. And you can argue whether that's too much or too little. Mm. There's always a color that a certain gamer would like, and he says, you know, can I have Pixie Pink for my army? I'm painting Slanesh. And I have to think, how many other people on the planet would buy that? And the two others that would is probably not worth for us to go into production. Mm. So it is one of those where all the current war paints and all the current primers are going to stay as they are. Mm-hmm. We basically just build it up to be a complete range now. Mm. It's our bit, and, you know, we've got some pretty hefty people to help us with this, so it's which we try not to have any range fillers. You know, we don't have 18 different variations of orange. Mm-hmm. We do have some, but not that many, and we don't have 200 variations of green. We have what we think is what people need to paint fantasy sci-fi, and there will always be some color in between. But the good thing is now that we come in with a mixing medium we haven't had before. So if there's really a certain tone of a color you'd like lighter or darker, we now got the mixing medium, so you can make a perfect war paint yourself in your living room. So it's all sort of a whole range without taking the piss of too many colors.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, I know my friend Romain, he's a Parisian, is probably sitting out there behind his PC right now going, too many colors, no such thing. But I do see what you mean, because whenever I myself am sitting down to paint a force, I'll pick, say, maybe a selection of 10 paints max. That's going to do my entire faction, and I'm going to keep those themes running right the way through it. Whereas if I looked at it and went, I could possibly put 20, 30, 40 paints, different colors into this, I would be there all day, and I would constantly be wondering, do I add more, do I add more? So there comes that level of painting stuff where it's, okay, I want to keep it within a nice contained set, I want to keep a nice theme running through everything, and that's something that I've always found that the Army Painter does really, really well for me in my painting. So it's something that really impresses me. Now, we do have a competition for this little interview. With the new range coming out, you guys have new names to put onto all the paints. And you guys have decided to let one of our community members actually name one of your paints. So what color is it? What color is this paint going to be?
Right. I'm not going to say what RAL code or NTSC code it is, mm-hmm. but it is a lighter blue. Mm-hmm. And you should have some pictures of that specific blue in conjunction with other colors to give an idea what it is.
Right.
And basically, we'd like, the name should be two, so it could be something like, you know, chocolate dye blue or whatever that is.
Right.
That.
So you like double-barreled names, as we would describe
it
here
now. Yes, it could be sci-fi and fantasy-related, mm-hmm. or it could have a purpose, mm-hmm. like leather brown. That's used for leather, or flesh wash is used for flesh as well. So there's no limit in it, as long as it's two names, and it's not an IP name, so you can't call it, Gandalf Blue.
Okay.
You wouldn't win if you did. You
could. Yeah, right. Well, I tell you what, let's keep this competition really self-contained and really easy for you guys, because you guys are going to have to work through all the names that people are going to feed in and pick them out. So I'm going to say this to everybody watching this now. If you're wanting to enter this contest, put your comment on beastsofwar.com on this post, because that'll just make life so much easier for the guys over at Army Painters to actually run through and pick out their favorite name from it. Now, the other thing you guys are bringing is effect paints, you said. Now, what are these going to do?
The fantasy paint sets. Like these, you mean?
Oh, right, so you're doing some Kings of War paint sets. Okay, I hadn't realized. I actually have a few Kings of War armies on the go.
There you go. Yes, we're coming up with some fantasy paint sets in conjunction with Mantic Games, which we like to work with as well. Mm. And they are for faction sets, undead, green skin. Mm-hmm. We've got ogres coming out, and the last one is dwarves. And these are the four sets, kind of, where we've tailored our new range into these. So if you want to try out the new colors, the effect paints as well, before it's been released, they are included in here. And they fit the Mantic range perfectly. So
that's what I was asking about. You've said you have effect paints. Now, what are these for? I'll assume effects of some sort. But can you give us a clue as to what sort of effect they're going to make?
Yes, we in our Zombicide range of paint sets, we have something called Glistening Blood, which is basically a blood color with very much gloss in it. Mm-hmm. So instead of having the typical matte acrylic surfaces that our paints have. Mm-hmm. You have a scale from 1 to 100, mm-hmm. and our normal paints are about 7, and a gloss effect would be maybe 70. Mm-hmm. So it's very, very glistening in this case, and it could be something like slime, or simply just a gloss varnish in itself. If you want to have gems standing out after you're given an anti shine, you can do that. Mm-hmm. It's also mixing mediums. We got for our quick shade washes and for our acrylics. Mm-hmm. So you can mix them, you can make them thinner, dilute them, whatever you want to do for glazing or how you want to work. So the whole range has a lot of effects in it to enhance the overall look of your army once you're done.
Now, okay, I really, really love the idea of that, because painting is always the level up. So you'll start out, your first army, you're going to put paint down on it, it's not going to look great. But as you move through your hobby life and actually start painting more and more stuff, you suddenly pick up those little nuances and stuff. And it's nice to have a system that's going to let you take those next steps and actually step up to the next level of painting. So say I've already painted a Kings of War army, and I want to revisit it and actually throw some nice blood effects into it. I mean, I'm about to paint an orc army. So if I was coming back and saying, right, the weapons on these orcs look far too clean, I need to bloody these up as if they've just been in a great, nasty melee. So actually having that is going to be a really, really great thing. Is that everything that's coming in the range, Bo, or is there even more?
No, well, there's dry rust when we talk about effects as well, which is sort of the other scale of gloss, obviously, which you can add to your weapons along with the blood. Mm-hmm. I think basically it's more what we have now. There will be some more metallics. Mm-hmm. True copper will come out. There's just a few inks that we worked on. The flesh wash is going to be part of our standard range. Mm-hmm. Some other, a tank shader coming out, that's work in progress. I don't know exactly what we are going to call that yet, but we're working on that. A lighter ink of brown type, so it's lighter than the soft. There'll be some different things you can work with. The cool thing about this is that it fits into the Army Painter system as it is. If you're completely novice, there's none of the colors or none of the effects you can't use, because they're not expert wide. That means that if you want to have blood on your sword once you've dipped your models and anti-shined them, a lot of people do. You can just add the blood or the rust effects or whatever you want to do. Mm-hmm. But if you're an expert painter as well, like some of the guys we have testing it for us and worked on it, heavy metal painters, it's all about you can also use them to a high effect where you blend and where you glaze and where you use the mediums to other effects than just base coat, which is the four-step technique, spray, paint, dip, done. it allows you to get an army fast on the table by just base coating. And then the quick shade and the stuff will do the rest. But if you want to take it up, all the new inks, I mean, you can go mental on the amount of effects you can make with the set. And there's only still 124 complete in the range. Mm. So what's good about it is that it's an affordable range as such. I mean, if you have to buy a full range of 300-400 paints, it's simply too much. And as you mentioned before, you work on a color palette of maybe 5 to 10 colors on an army with highlights on. Yeah, for that specific army, you could just buy, you know, an army set if you wanted. But obviously, you're going to paint more models, more armies, new miniatures afterwards. Mm-hmm. So the whole package is just, we try to make it as retail friendly as possible and as end user friendly as mm-hmm. possible. For the wargamer, if you have this, you don't need anything else. That's the kind of the angle we went about when we designed it. So you have the three steps of, you know, colors that are matched to each other. Mm-hmm. If you don't want to blend, you just want to highlight. You've got three colors matching through the system. But you can also go mental and add all your mediums and do all the kinds of effects you want. So it should be a box for everyone, which I know is one size fits all, really do. But in this case, we've really done our best to make it just that, basically.
All right, well, I'll tell you what, Bo, I am really looking forward to seeing some of these Kings of War army sets coming. I'm really looking forward to the effect paints that are coming. And I'm looking forward to just seeing what you guys do in general for the increased color palette that you're going for. So I'll tell you what, guys, get your comments in below. Don't forget, you can win the chance to actually name one of the new paints for the Army Painter range. Get your comments in below on beastofwar.com, and don't forget, make the name a two-word piece. So something like Sky Blue, not Gandalf Blue, because that's IP infringed. We'll move on here, and we will see you later.
From Viking halls to the cities of the future, terrain buffs will love our foreground hub. Watch gaming tables of all genres come to life at beastofwar.com. Progress comes to a world of magic as science and the arcane combine to make marvels. Meet steampunk inventors and orc mystics at the Volsung Hub on beastofwar.com.
Hi guys, and welcome back. As you can see, I've booted Warren out of the studio because I am joined by Phil Yates from Battlefront. It is a pleasure to have you in the show, sir.
Good to be here.
And I'm, of course, joined by John, because we are beginning to talk about some Team Yankee. So, mm-hmm. Phil, what is the latest and greatest that's been happening in the world of Team Yankee?
Well, Leopard. We're not talking about animals here. We're talking about the beast you've got in front of you.
Yeah, we're talking about one of the steel beasts. Now, we are keeping this a little bit further out, but you can see this is something really, really nice, and this is one of the ones that Good Master Alliance has been working on for a project vlog. Yes, John?
That's correct, yeah. Don't forget, we've also been busy with Phil over the last week. We are actually filming a themed event on Leopard itself.
Yes. Team Yankee Leopard Week will be coming with to the internet airwaves.
The internet airwaves?
Words. Things. But no, it will be coming to the internet very, very soon, and mm-hmm. you will get a real feel for the new West German faction, which is entering the Team Yankee world. Mm-hmm. So, Phil, can you give people a bit of a tease as to what they expect from the West Germans?
Well, the West Germans, like any of the Germans should expect, are very, very professional. Mm. They, people talk about them being a conscript army, but what they really are is a professional army that trains a lot of privates mm-hmm. over and over again, but their officers and NCOs, professionals. Their equipment, top-notch, a very, very good army. So their skill levels are high, their determination to protect their homeland is high, and their equipment is great. Mm-hmm. But of course, very elite, very expensive, mm-hmm. and so forth. Although, you'll show them the other little leopard there.
Ah yes, we have one other one here, which is actually the Leopard 1. So you do have some options as to which way you want to go with it. It's the models are incredibly detailed. I am absolutely in love with the West Germans. Mm-hmm. I think they will be my faction because we've just spent the entire week with Phil filming a themed event, as John says, but also filming a series for Team Yankee. And from the factions that I have seen so far, because we do know there are other factions that are going to eventually have to turn up in the Team Yankee universe, the West Germans are my favorite so far, simply because Leopard 2 is a god on the tabletop. It is a steel beast mm-hmm. rolling out to deal some serious death. We have one other little vehicle here, and this isn't everything we've done. We do have a fully painted house army of these now for the event. But what is this, John?
This is, well, I don't want to say it in the German term because our accents seem to make it sound like something else. So we're going to call it the Fox.
The Fox.
Yep.
Which is actually very similar, apparently, to the German pronunciation anyway.
Yeah.
there's more of a U in there, let's be honest.
Not a lot listening to Google Translate's pronunciation, but Fuchs.
Okay. it just sounds like a more aggressive fox.
Yeah, it's a more aggressive fox.
That is one thing I'm noticing with this faction. They do play quite aggressively on the tabletop. Yeah. Once they actually start hitting and doing damage, they are incredibly good at dealing damage. But you'll have to wait for the entire themed week to actually get a real flavor for what this faction is going to do. Mm-hmm. Now, on top of that, for Team Yankee, we've actually been playing more and more demo games here in the office. And I have to say, now that we're actually getting to play it, because, right, everybody out there knows we ran a Team Yankee boot camp. Mm-hmm. The one curse of running boot camps is this. New shiny game comes into the office. Everybody who's coming to visit the office is getting excited, hyped, and really into the game.
Yep.
We're so damn busy during those, we don't get to play games as much as we want. So this week we've actually been able to bet in and actually play some Team Yankee with Phil. And Phil, I want to say thank you for coming across all the way from New Zealand to teach us idiots how to play the game.
Oh, well, you weren't that hard to teach.
That does not help.
Well, I mean, look, John, from your first impressions of Team Yankee, what are you getting the feel of it for so far?
I'm realizing that maybe I've been mistaken in some of my life choices, that maybe heavy armor isn't always the way. I have noticed a few nuances that come in and a few little tactics that have to be played that rely on your light vehicles. Mm. And I was looking at it going, but I really wanted tons of T-72s. I really wanted tons of every main battle tank. I was like, I want just lots of that.
Hang on. You can do that.
Yeah, it works. But I see, like, when we played a few of our games, it was more of, well, the light vehicles have got a very important role. The artillery has a very important role. And I was like, actually, I can expand and I won't feel bad about ignoring some of my main battle tank slots.
And let's be honest, with these factions, you do get some beautiful aircraft as well.
Oh, I mean, so like, many.
For the Russians, you've got the Frogfoot, you've got the Hind. For the Americans, you've got the Cobra and the A-10, mm-hmm. the Warthog. For the Germans, do we know who we're getting for them yet, or are you going to make people wait for it? Okay, you're going to have to wait. You're going to have to wait for the week to find out what air power you are getting for the West Germans. Mm-hmm. Right. For me, I'm loving this game because it's really giving me a different sense of the tactics that we're playing. For me, I'm always a 28mm skill wargamer. I've dabbled a little bit in 10mm. I've never went to 15mm before. So this week was actually my introduction to 15mm wargaming. Mm-hmm. And it feels so different to anything else. It's like you're standing higher up in the clouds and actually seeing more of the battlefield take shape and stuff. You know, it's not just, oh, I have a few tanks, you have a few tanks. This is a really nice, tight, gritty little fight. Yep. This is an overall, here is your segment of the battle of, you know, Lionsburg.
Lionsburg.
And today, you must defend your homeland, Messiah John, leader of the great nation.
Or leader of this town. I'm a mayor of a town.
You're a mayor of a town. Okay.
I also want to say to you, Justin, as well, this probably appeals to you more as a game in comparison to, like, the World War II, you know, Flames of War and such like that. Because, well, World War II is always my passion, so I can always tell you what's going on.
Yeah.
But because Team Yankee is post-war, and I'm not totally up on my post-war, I think both of us were coming to it with a sense of, I kind of know what it is, but I don't know how it's going to behave.
Yeah.
And I think for you, because it's less grounded in history, you've got you feel like there's a bit more scope that you can go, oh, I can make something crazy because this didn't exist or this didn't happen. But
we're in a what-if scenario, which is, Phil, this has got to be a big step for the guys at Battlefront, jumping from historical to the what-if.
It gives us the best of both worlds because we've got a lot of history to work on. And these things are real. You can go and actually find them, well, anywhere in Europe. You can go find various varieties of these and get to see them. And we don't have to make stuff up in the sense of we know what a German company looks like, a German platoon looks like, and so forth. So we get that solid basis of reality, which helps anchor everything. But it didn't happen. So what happens on your tabletop, how you pitch it and so forth is entirely up to you. I mean, we were talking the other day, H.W. Coyle, the author of Team Yankee, actually wrote a book called The 10,000, which pitted the Germans against the Americans.
Yes.
So there's lots of possibilities here.
Well, you see, this is the thing. Because of the way the war is now kicking off in Team Yankee, I could very well imagine there might be the odd German detachment that's going to stand there and go, you know what, no, I don't want the Americans fighting for me. I want to stand on my own 2 feet. No, you get out of here. And then that actually coming to a blue-on-blue fight, you know, which could make for some very interesting, you know, tabletop narratives and stuff if you're running campaigns and things. The other thing that's really going to interest me is whenever we see this advance to the next level again, because we do know new nations need to come in, and we're all just left sitting and wondering what is going to turn up. Now, guys, I'm going to say this now. I am going to take Phil into backstage tomorrow morning, twist his arm a little bit, and see if we can find out what's coming next just for all of our main site members. Now, I know that's a little unfair, but I want to give them a little treat first. So are you up for that, Phil?
Indeed.
All right. So that's Team Yankee. Mm-hmm. The other thing I wanted to talk to you about is tanks.
Yep.
Now, that game, it's small, it's light, it's pick up and play, but it has exploded onto the market. Whenever I was at Salute this year, I had Gordon turning to me going, right, you're wanting one for a prize, take this one off the shelf, there is two left, you will not get one after this.
Yeah.
You know, so it was amazing the response.
People have been sort of unfortunately disappointed around the world because we produced what we thought was going to be enough for the initial release.
Exactly.
And by the time we actually had the stuff to the shops, it had long sold out at the wholesale level. And the time it took us to catch up and make twice as much again, which is now hitting the shops again. So you should be able to get it now.
Yeah.
But there was this delay because it was like, well, we've now made three times as much as we thought we would need.
Yeah.
And
you see, that's something you get. The odd time you do get that sleeper hit. Now, we actually have some of the bits sitting behind you that I'd like to bring under camera.
We do.
Yeah.
And it's one thing. We actually did this a little while ago where we actually showed off some of the mechanics, but that was whenever it was just myself, John, and Lloyd messing around on the tabletop a little bit. So now that we actually have you here, Phil, I want you to take us through one round of this, okay?
Yeah, not a problem.
Now, let's see, I think, okay, we have a couple of bits of terrain, but I want more, so I've actually brought something of Lloyd's along, which I think you'll get a kick out of, Phil. I don't know if you've seen this
yet. No, I haven't.
But Lloyd and John, a little while ago, did a hobby lab for these. And it doesn't look like much from this point, but whenever I undo this and start flipping stuff off, if you give them a second, these should begin to raise up and become rock formations.
They're getting there. Yeah.
They're going incredibly slowly. I wonder what happened. Well,
they used to go faster, I take it.
Whenever we first did these, they would literally spring up in like 3 seconds, but I think these have been really compressed for a while. So
you need to add a little water.
Water your pop-up rods.
It might.
But let's pick a couple of these, and they will expand as we play. So let's say one of those, two of those, and right, John, do you want
Let's just give you some room. Yep.
Yeah.
Would
you like the Panther or would you like the Shermans?
Oh, I'm taking the Panther.
Okay,
I'm sorry.
I'm getting the two American Shermans, which are what you get in the box.
A measuring stick?
Yeah, so I'll deploy my two just here on the edge of camera shot. We've got a little building in the middle. And yeah, you can
two
see the rocks are starting to pop up. Okay, so I've got two cards. Right, and you've got your Panther. So I literally just want to do one sequence of play. Now, I think there are some dice behind you as well, which I think we're going to need for this.
Need.
Oh, excuse me. Okay, so we have some dice, we have some tanks, we have the tokens, we have the damage deck, and we have our movement counters.
Yep. Okay, movement.
Yeah.
Like most rules, it goes movement, shooting, cleanup.
Okay. Right, I assume we need to see who's going first.
Nope. On your card there, you'll see in blue that you have an initiative rating.
Oh, okay. I'm initiative 6 on both of my Shermans.
And I'm initiative 7 on the Panther.
Okay.
Okay, so the lowest initiative moves first.
Okay. I'm going to be reasonably clever with this. Now, this is our little movement widget.
Yep.
So I assume I put this onto my tank somewhere and decide where my stuff is going to move to.
Yep. Now, the interesting thing is at the end of it. We've got that there. Yep, you can see that. I put it there or here or anywhere I like, but I'll put it there because it's nice and easy to see. And then at the end of it, I must be square up against it.
So
any direction you like, but square.
So what I was thinking of doing here was that I was going to have to drive like this and end like this. What I can actually do is drive like that and end that way.
Yep.
Okay, that'll work for that.
You can move again if you want. You can move once or twice.
No, I'm only going to move the once.
Okay, we're going to put a marker there. We'll see what that does in a moment.
Okay, and the other tank, simply because I know John has two targets to deal with, I'll put him to here like this, and he will indeed move a second time to here, like so, and be turned, like so.
Cool. And we'll put a 2 with that one.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So that's my movement done. Do I now get to shoot?
Nope.
I get to move, don't I? Yep.
Ah, okay.
Okay.
So, and it's not turn by turn, it's just tank order. So if you had, for instance, a 5, John had a 6, you had a 6, and then 7. Mm-hmm. We've already, earlier in the, right at the beginning of the game, decided who wins ties on things.
Yep.
So you'd do the 5, then the 6, then the 6, then the 7.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, John, your movement.
All right.
I've kind of went aggressive with the Shermans, which I think I've had
yes,
today.
Yes, well, okay. So the Panther is going to think I'm going to try and get him to do a second move.
Okay.
Because that's how we're going to roll. And we're going to end our movement right there.
Yeah.
I'll just bring that turret to bear, I think.
And we'll put a 2 on that to indicate that it's moving to.
I'll have this one to bear, and I think I still have just enough to catch you with this one.
Quite possibly.
Okay.
So, we're down
movement
to the shoot step. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So now it's going to be shooting.
Okay, so.
Shooting is done in the other initiative.
Oh.
So Panther fires first.
Yeah, here's your dice, John.
Okay.
So I assume you're firing at my little Sherman 76 here.
Yes.
Yes?
A point blank. No distance.
So if you look at the red number there, that's how many dice you're going to roll.
So I'm going to roll 5 dice, which are my attack dice.
Yep.
Okay.
4s, 5s, and 6s hits, with mm-hmm. 6 being criticals.
Okay.
All right. So.
Yeah.
Not bad rolling. 3. No criticals, but 4 hits.
Yep. 4 hits.
Yikes.
So, yeah, that's pretty good.
So the question then is, Justin, can you survive that?
Okay, well, for defense, I believe that's the shield on this. So
if
you look here, you can see there's a 1 with a shield beside it. So I get 1 dice to start with.
Yep.
And then how many after that, Phil?
You get 1 because you moved.
Uh-huh.
2 because the Panther moved.
Uh-huh.
So that gets you up to 4.
Yeah.
If there was cover, you might get better and so forth.
Okay, now very quickly, how does cover work?
Okay, basically, if they can see 3 corners of your tank, you're not concealed.
Okay.
If they can't see 3 corners, then you're concealed.
Okay.
And that gives you 1 more dice.
Okay.
Now, so you can also lose dice.
Oh.
You are within an arrow of them. You lose a dice.
Oh. So I'm down to 3.
Yes, and he's behind the front of your tank. You lose a dice.
Oh! Okay, so this is showing side armor, yeah?
Yep.
So I'm definitely taking 1 damage.
Yep.
But I have a chance to get rid of the other 2. And is that 4, 5, and 6 again?
4.
There were 4, yeah.
There was 4 hits.
Yeah, you've only got 2 dice there, haven't you?
Oh, yeah. So I'm definitely taking 2 damage.
Yep.
Well, let's see what I can get here. 5 and a 2, so that's
the
3
5
damage.
Will cancel 1.
Yep.
But yeah, you're going to take 3.
Okay, and then, okay, so we just have little damage counters sit beside our tank to actually let it run.
But again, on your thing, you can see that you've got a strength of 6 or an arm.
I've got 6 hit points marked.
6 hit points, that's the one.
Yeah.
So you're not destroyed. Now, even if you were destroyed, there's a rule called Final Fury.
Uh-huh.
It means that you still get to shoot. You're not destroyed until the end of the turn.
Ah, I see. Mm. Now, that I like because it gives you that last chance to dig someone back.
Yeah.
So, as it stands, I think I have 2 shots at John. So, 1 from my 76 and 1 from my 75. So, from my 76 to start with, because he's taking the most damage, he starts with 5.
Cool.
And I assume that's it, yeah?
Yep.
So, 4s, 5s, and 6s.
Oh, and we've got a 6, a crit, and a 4.
A hit, so,
1 hit, 1 crit.
One hit, one crit. So, that should be okay.
All right.
Now, your defense is?
My defense is 2.
So we'll give you 2 dice for that.
Okay, so 2 dice to start.
You moved 2.
Moved 2.
So we'll give you 2 dice for that.
Yep.
John moved. Justin moved 1. Normally, that would give you a dice, but there's a special rule called gung-ho, which means that the Americans can ignore their first
I'll quickly read the rule. Treat this tank as making 1 less move than shown on its speed token when calculating the target's defense dice.
So it's technically done 0.
Yes.
Yep.
So I have 4.
4 dice. However,
he's within an arrow of
you. He's within an arrow of you, and in getting past him, he's past you.
Ah.
Flank shot.
Totally. So I need to pass both of these
to be undamaged.
Be okay.
Okay.
Well.
Double six.
Yeah. You need to go to Vegas, my son.
The 6s allow you to cancel crit, so even if you just rolled 1 6, that would cancel the crit, and you'd only take 1 damage. Mm. Now, while we're just looking at things, crits, just draw a card.
Yep.
So in this one, nothing special. Lucky hit, double damage.
Yeah. Okay.
But some of them do things like knocking your engine, crew out, ammunition explosion, which is particularly nasty.
I'm sure it is.
Okay, well, I still have my Sherman 75 to roll for.
Yep.
So let's just finish up the turn.
Yep.
So I'll roll for it. Four dice, yeah?
Yes. And all missed.
All missed.
Oh, dear.
Unfortunate. But I assume that does just happen, that sometimes you will miss everything.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that's a basic turn. Now, is there anything else that we haven't covered for a turn? Now, let's say John had taken the critical hit and he had something that was doing him, say, an effect.
Let's find a more interesting one. Failed out. There's an interesting effect.
Okay.
This tank cannot move or shoot.
But it is taking no damage.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And it's also marked here as repairable.
Yeah.
So what that means is in the command step at the end, John has a chance to repair it. Roll a die, 4, 5, or 6, it's repaired.
Mm-hmm.
Except that you also have a choice. You have the Blitzkrieg special rule on your Panther there.
Mm-hmm. Which is, this tank may make a single move instead of making a repair damage roll in the command phase.
Okay, right. So even though he's bailed out, he can still sort of shuffle about?
Well, no, because he can't actually move. Yep. So that wasn't the best one to choose. What do we got? Engine fire. No, come on, let's get something that doesn't affect movement. Ah, oh, come on. Ah! Okay. Say, for instance, you had one that put your gun out of action or made your shooting worse or something.
Mm-hmm.
You'd now have a choice. The Americans, no choice. They repair it because they've got no other option.
Yeah.
But you can either do a free move, which you might use to say, okay, I don't like where that other Sherman is. I'm going to move here and get out of sight of it, especially if it was immobile or something.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Or you could stay where you are and roll your die and try and improve, fix the tank.
Mm-hmm. So is it just a 4-up to repair, I'm guessing? Okay.
Right,
well, that's a basic turn of tanks. I will say, I want to get a full game of this on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, actually seeing how quick and easy it is now, I think we could get a very nice little battle in. So I tell you what, guys, I think we're going to call it for today. Hopefully you'll join us tomorrow morning, where we will be having Phil back for another chat about the future of Team Yankee. We will also be having many discussions on lots of other great topics. If you've never had a look at our backstage content before, it is a wonderful time for you to do it, because we have basically myself and Warren are coming back in the morning. Our XLBS show is an entire new show where you get to come and spend Sunday morning with us on our main website. But we will move on here. Hopefully you've enjoyed the show. Drop your comments below to enter the competition for the Armour Painter Prize. We'll see you tomorrow morning.
Keep your blaster handy. The West is a dangerous place. Fight to survive as men turn to monsters and the dead rise on the Wild West Exodus Hub at beastsofwar.com. Anime cyberpunk style meets skirmish combat in Infinity. Experience 8 high-tech factions and fight to control the human sphere at the Infinity Hub on beastsofwar.com.